Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the Sounds From The Cellar, hosted by the Olive Tree Madmen. Today's guests are a group of extraordinary gentlemen, masters at their craft, and pioneers in their field. Six of them. You know them probably from the soundtrack of Do The Right Thing, from their freshman album, Take Six, and the assortment collection of bodies of work that they've produced through the years. Ladies and gentlemen, Take Six.
One, two, three.
Six to Sounds From The Cellar. Thank you so much.
Thank you for having us.
Yeah. I know you got up super early to warm up and do your thing.
No, we're still asleep.
We haven't even woken up yet.
See, boys? It is possible.
Exactly.
Incredible.
In your sleep.
Yeah. Big show at Sony Hall. I know you guys are traveling on to Boston, but I know Nick has some burning questions here for you, so
Yeah.
Go for it.
I wanted to talk about the arranging process. Who's arranging right now?
Right now, it's always Mark.
It's always Mark.
Always Mark.
But not alone. Not alone.
But not alone.
Well, before we get into the arranging, let's talk about how Take Six became Take Six.
Oh, man. We started as a quartet. I was a freshman at Oakwood University. It was way, way, way back, 1980. Because there are a lot of a cappella groups at Oakwood. So I just had a group, and we used to rehearse in a bathroom because everybody knows you sound really good in the bathroom.
At least you think you do.
You think you do, yes. But one day we were rehearsing, and Mark Kibble came into that bathroom, added a fifth part, and just joined on the spot. And so he became the arranger, needed one more guy to fill out the things that were in his head, and we added one more member and became, I think, only the only sextet on campus. So we had
Are you saying that Mark just took over the group?
He took over the group. He sure did.
Only the arranging part. Only the arranging
and,
part.
You know,
nobody move Claude out of his position.
He made it into what we are. He made it into what we are. So, I mean, that was the humble beginnings.
Incredible. Yeah, so when you come up with a new arrangement, Margaret, everybody, do you write it down? How does the rehearsal process work?
Well, first, the arrangement has to happen, and, you know, I'll go away. Back in the day, I would work everything out on the piano, and we would all stand around the piano or sit around the piano and learn parts, and I would just dish parts out from just playing the piano, playing the arrangement, section at a time until we got the whole song. Now, it's different because we have modern technology where, you know, I can actually do the entire demo with a DAW or sequencer, sing the whole thing down, and I just send it out to them. They record their parts on it, and it's done like that. The rehearsal project, the part of it is a little different because that it really does take sitting down together and rehearsing sections and shining them and making sure that they're right before we actually perform it and committing it to memory, which is very, very, very important.
Right. You guys memorize everything?
Yes, absolutely.
Always, right? Yeah.
Absolutely.
That's incredible. Yeah, so the retention level, I'm trying to wrap my head around the retention level over here because these are complicated parts. And so you just polish them in rehearsal, sit down, and just remember them.
It's funny. After doing it for so many years, we're very used to the part. And sometimes I don't even have to give the part out. We already know it based on what I'm playing.
Right.
Because they know where they fit.
You kind of know where you are in your range in the particular chord. So you kind of know where you are automatically.
So it's gotten a lot faster than it used to be.
Got it. Okay, cool. I want to ask you guys about like show prep and like warm-up routine and stuff. Do you guys warm up as a group together? Do you guys do it individually?
Ooh, it's all different.
It's all different.
A little bit of both.
A little bit of both.
You know, and back in the day, we used to just play basketball.
Right.
Yeah. Just get out, play some basketball, get up, didn't warm up vocally at all. As we got older, it was like, oh, wait. Bing, bing, bing. You know, you start losing it. So
there's really something to the to like warming up the voice with like just working out or like running or something.
Absolutely.
I kind of found that out late in life.
Getting the blood flowing.
It's incredible. It's incredible. It's like all of a sudden there's moisture in the chords and you don't sound so trashy.
And if you come to our dressing room, we're singing all the time.
All the time.
Yeah.
Well, yes. Yeah. Your significant others must be rolling their eyes the whole time.
All the time.
Oh, you've been in my car. I get it.
Long car rides. They're just like, oh my God.
I need you to sing the bass
this
line.
Song again.
It's funny. It really depends on what we've been doing before. If we have, you know, done shows before and our voices are tired and warm-ups are absolutely critical.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
If we haven't been, then you won't hear very much. We'll get out and sound check and do our warm-up there. That's pretty much it.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
Old school. Amazing. So, like, when you guys go to a place like Colorado or stuff like that, how's the hydration game for you guys? I'm sorry, I'm asking a bunch of singer questions.
These are great questions.
Like, you know what I mean? Like, diet, hydration, how do you guys plan ahead for that? How do you do it?
Well, it's sort of a culture. I was going to say.
Yeah, just to breathe in Colorado, you need a lot of water, which turns into oxygen. So, yeah,
right.
we try to do that and get a lot of rest. Rest is the key.
Yeah.
Taking care of your instrument. No more screaming, though it's the playoffs. No screaming.
And we have a culture in the group of drinking a lot of water anyway. So that's just our thing.
And you got to be aware. I just learned really from a vocal coach that the traveling that you do, it's when the plane takes off and lands that you will get dehydrated.
Really?
Not so much the length of the trip, but it's like you don't feel that when you land. So
is there a reason for that, Joey? Did they say?
I don't know if it's a pressure change. I don't know what the case is, but the reason why it's important is because you have to rehydrate even though you don't feel like you're thirsty.
Right.
But you'll find out when you get up on stage and it's like your throat is dry, your voice seems dry.
Right.
And then you realize, oh, man, I haven't been hydrating this whole time.
Right. What do you call it? The jerky throat?
One of the names I give it is the jerky throat. Yeah.
Jerky throat.
Okay, yeah, that's it.
No control.
You know, in like New York City, like heating, particularly in the older buildings, you're just, oh, my God. Yeah.
Drying out with that heat. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, as a group, we see throughout history, a lot of them don't always stay together.
Yep.
How have y'all managed to stay together this long, and how do y'all deal with disagreements?
I think that we've had to learn how to get into the realm of really respecting each other. It's more than just liking each other, because I think that you can go in and out of like, but it's kind of like family. You know, we are together as a family. We're transparent with each other. We try to make sure everybody is always heard. I think that's one of the things that breaks a lot of groups up. You'll find out later on that I never got to tell you what to say. No, we try to get everything out. And we try to deal in respect in those things.
Yep.
Now, sometimes that's a hard thing to do. But I think because we, underneath it all, have a culture of love that we're able to do those things and move forward.
And it's just like a marriage. You know, they say if you make it past 2 years in your marriage, you're going to make it till about seven. Make it past seven, you can make it till about 15.
Yeah.
And then make it past 15, you're pretty much good.
Yeah.
And so, you know, for us, we've had rough spots where I would say probably all of us have had thoughts of saying, this is it, I can't take it anymore.
Done, son.
But especially at the beginning from that second 7 and 15 year period, it was also a ministry for us. Mm. So we felt like this was a calling. So times when we just couldn't take it, we feel like this is where God wants us to be. If he wants us to be here, he'll give us the strength to keep going. So,
right. Facts. So how does spirituality fit into, like, your performances?
It's the beginning, middle, and end.
It's who we are.
That's it. Yeah. Yep.
It's who we are.
In fact, to kind of continue with what he was saying, we are very much, we're not the best singers, but we're the most committed guys in music to one another and to this craft.
Yeah.
Right.
And you got six guys, you know, they say the thing about the fist, you can do anything.
Right.
We've seen some amazing highs and some amazing lows in an industry that changes all the time.
Right.
And an entourage that comes and goes depending on what your last performance did. It's funny how crowded the dressing room gets when you kill it.
Right.
but we're committed to each other, and it's all submitting to him. You know, because it could be about him. It could be about all of us can get into yourself. Right. But if you remember, all right, this dude is actually tripping, but I'm here for the group and for the good of the group. Or I'm actually tripping, but we're here for the good of the group. Then you keep pushing.
And once you accept that culture, it becomes a thing of when problems arise, when differences arise, you don't think to how can I get out of here? You think, how can we fix this? Because we know this is the good thing.
Right.
Yeah, and I'll continue on that a little bit. The Bible talks about how when a man and woman get married, the two shall become one. Well, this is kind of like a marriage. We're becoming in this group.
Right.
When I got in the group in 2004, I wasn't the man that I am now. I became a better man, a better father because of these guys, a better husband because of these guys, a better performer. All of the things that have to do with the craft, but also all the things that have to do with just life in general.
Right.
You know, when I see these guys walk through difficult times that and we band together, that actually makes us stronger. You know, so when you talk about the spiritual part of it, it comes out in everything that we do. It comes out in our conversations that we're having in the dressing room. It comes out in our performances when we need to do an audible in the middle of the show because somebody really needs to get something off of their spirit. That's how we become who we are, you know?
You got to leave a little room for the Lord.
It's amazing that what sound like your whole purpose in life and music career, it's just unified. There's no separation between how you are as friends or as individuals, because you know at the core of everything is just you. You know, you can be with everybody, and you can be with your family, and then you can be in your career and your business things, and it just sounds all, you know, so cohesive.
But you know, it took all these years to learn to bring all those into congruence.
Right.
Because we were people on the road, and then we were people at home. And then,
right.
But we had to learn that you're that same person in all of those different areas. Mm-hmm. If they're not in congruence, then there's a work for you to do.
Right.
And that's to speak to your question about the spirituality part of it. Mm-hmm. We can say biblical stuff, but your affect has to agree with it. Your facial expressions, the rest of how you communicate has got to be in agreement with what you say, so that sometimes we get in front of crowds and we don't say anything biblical or Jesus related, but they can feel and they can sense that Christ's love is there, and they can't explain it. They don't know why.
Right.
They just had a great experience and don't know why. We had to learn how to be congruent in all these different ways as a husband, as a brother, as a group member, as a father. And then it speaks to the strength of it. The core of who you are is connected with God. He's like in you at all times, walking his purposes out inside you. Mm-hmm. And that core is what helps to keep then the rest of us also together when we're not in agreement with each other.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
When we can't stand each other at the moment. Mm-hmm. That core is what's the unifying factor is.
Your nucleus.
Okay. Now, y'all came out as a gospel group in the gospel category. But y'all do other types of music. How has it been received walking that fine line between secular and non-secular music?
I'll start off by saying this, and it's connect the last thing. That's the particular situation where we felt like, man, we gotta be saying Jesus, Jesus, Jesus all the time, or we're not considered gospel. But you're learning the whole time that it's not just what you're saying. At the moment, we may pick a song that is absolutely in agreement with what his principles of love are, and you may not have heard his name anywhere in it. So people, as they're trying to define the difference between secular and sacred and gospel and whatever, that issue came up until we realized, wait a minute, this is not just the song I'm singing at the moment or the name I'm saying. It's actually who I'm committed to. And how that works itself out. And so eventually over the years, we started to realize that, well, it's okay. Yes, people consider it gospel at first, and now they consider it jazz, but we're the same God-fearing men who choose to walk that out in different genres of music. If the genre doesn't align with who he is, we're not connected to that. We walk out what's already inside. So, yes, that was an issue when we first started out. But now we're realizing, wait a minute, we're the same God-loving, God-fearing people. And these people, now here's where it really makes a difference. Some people really are turned off by the Bible stuff because they've had bad experiences. Mm-hmm. So they need you to actually communicate in love to them. To let them know, you know what? No, this relationship is most important first, and we value you. Sometimes you got to come in the back door and let them know what that love of Christ looks like from the back door, because they're turned off with what happened when they tried to come in the front door.
Right.
Does that make sense?
And what speaks to the congruency, continuing with what Joey is saying, is the irony is at the beginning, we thought we were singing Christian music or gospel music, but everyone else in the secular world thought we were singing jazz.
Right.
So then suddenly it was like we were a jazz band at the beginning. Right. And then suddenly somewhere along the way, it switched. And then they were like, you guys are a gospel group. And we were doing, I'm not going to say any names, but we were doing a performance and we're singing, you know, regular Take Six stuff. We might even be singing that Earth, Wind & Fire song that we opened with. And somebody in the back shouts, what about Jesus? And it's like, wow, you know, we had to learn. Back to what Joey was saying, that congruency actually was our issue.
Right.
And what we had to learn how to do is it's not really about how people perceive you. It's about who we understand who we are and what we've been sent here and put here to do.
Man, I had this fan come up to me. It was like, I'm confused. Are you a gospel group or are you a secular group?
Right.
I was like,
we're a vocal group.
I said, I asked dude, I was like, I mean, it's just second nature. Like, are you a husband or a father?
Right. Wow.
He was like, I'm both. I was like, exactly. Mm-hmm. So you communicate love to your wife in one way and your children in another way, but you're the same person. Right. So however you rectify that in your mind and that congruence, that's what I had to, and each one of us had to come to individually. Right. So we don't have to worry about when we sing Let's Stay Together versus, you know, Jesus Keep Me Near the Cross. It doesn't really matter because this is who we are.
Right.
Personally, so
and
we
staying near the cross is how you stay together. So
hello?
That's how you do it.
Holla at your boy.
Yeah, I mean, I play in a band called The Nth Power, and we believe in the healing power of music, and we have a lot of spiritual undertones and overtones in all our music. But one thing I wanted to ask you guys about is testimonials from concerts. We've had experiences where people have come up and said, you know, one guy was like, I tried to kill myself and I put your album on repeat in my car, in my garage, and I turned it on, and then I woke up somehow, and this song that we have about addiction was playing, and about, you know, asking for, you know, guidance and everything, and that, and do you guys have any testimonials from past shows that
almost,
you could share?
Almost identical to that story. Claude and I were flying back on Southwest Airlines one time, you know, you can sit where you want.
Yeah.
Coming through early morning, Sunday one morning, this guy comes in, you know, we're big guys, and he comes in, sits in the middle seat, like this big empty plane, or like, dude.
Right.
He was a fan, recognized who we were, and couldn't wait to share what, you know, what we had done through our music. And he said that he grew up many, many years homeless. Mm-hmm. And they were living in a van. He said there were many, many nights when it got so cold that his mom would turn on the van for just a little bit to warm up the car, just to keep him going. And Quiet Place was in a cassette in the van.
Wow.
He said, your music saved my life. And every time he hears that song, he tears up. And it just the impact of what that meant. It was life and death to him. And that's not us. That's a God thing.
Right. Yeah.
You know, back to what are you singing about? Why are you singing about it? That is where it comes from, because this is life and death. The enemy is not playing games. He's not pulling punches, you know, being gentle and all that kind of thing. Boom. And so it's life and death. That's why we're still here.
Yeah, we had to learn, you know, as you mature, it's the practicality of your spirituality becomes another whole thing. You know, it's not always just, you know, pray about something and it'll work. While we believe in prayer and we know that prayer works, your relationship to God might tell you, you know, there's a mental health issue here as well.
Right.
There's an addiction issue here as well, you know. And so we've had to learn that through the years and stop trying to just say nice words to people. Reach them where they actually are. Right. You know what I mean?
Well, speaking of spirituality, why don't we hear another song that delves in that?
Yeah, man, one of my favorite songs that y'all ever did, Over the Hill is Home. Hey. Who's playing piano on that record?
Cedric is originally playing the piano. He co-wrote it
Cedric
with
Dent.
Cedric Dent, former member. We wrote it together. And the story behind that song, not many people know.
Let's go.
Is one of our members... had a child pass.
Oh, man.
And the night that it happened, Cedric called me. He's like, man, I got this song. It was something about there's a light at the end of the road, or there's, you just got to push or just keep going or something. But he had definitely had that in mind. We got together and was like, down this road, there's help. Just keep going.
Right.
You know, we got to encourage each other. We're like, over the hill is home. And right. we kind of walked that forward. So that's where that song comes from. It's when Joey sings it, he's the only one who's ever sung it. Every time it hits a chord and it pulls in emotionally where people are, that's a song where people have talked to us in tears after they hear it. So right. we're glad to do it for you this morning.
Amazing. Wow.
So recently we've had quite a few of the whole group. We've had somebody, some friend, some relationship, somebody has lost a loved one to death. And it's been pretty impactful. I mean, Kristen just lost his father-in-law. I think it was last week. And Mark and I also lost our uncle, Uncle Herman Kibble. A lot of our uncles and aunts, they're all being laid to rest now. So
parents,
yeah. parents, and you know, we're of that age. And we can't get to the funeral because we're going to actually be out at sea. But we wanted to pass on that hope that, you know, God's promises are true. We're going to see these people again. But for now, as they're resting in Christ, it's like, you know what? Just remember that his promises are true. His word is going to be walked out. And because of that, you can take hope now. So we're going to dedicate this next song to not just Christian's family and Mark and I's family, but anybody who's dealing with this kind of sorrow, that you can hope firmly in God's word. Over the hill is home. Day it's two men walked. I heard one say this road is rough, and I don't know if I'll make it through. Then the other turned and said, stay your course, for just ahead the place you seek is sure to come to you. But it's over
the hill is home. Mm-hmm. Just down the road is shelter. When you don't feel like trying,
keep on. Is home. So if you ever find yourself out of strength, in need of help, know that hope is just a prayer away. Oh yes it is. The strength of God is always near. A faithful guide, he'll lead you there. His mission is to show us the way. Whoa,
over the hill is home.
Oh my, just down the road is shelter.
Road.
Oh yeah,
shelter.
Yeah. Is home.
On the other side of night,
oh, yeah, yeah,
comes
yeah.
a day that shines so bright.
Over the hill is home. Oh,
through the valleys, he will guide.
Through the valleys, he will guide you. Oh, yes, he will. See, over the hill. It's home, oh,
oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh.
Just down the road, it's
just down the road.
heal. It's whole.
The side of night comes a day that shines so bright.
I know about those days when it just doesn't feel like the sun is gonna rise again. But as long as God is on the throne,
He's
gonna be alright.
Hey.
Take six, ladies and gentlemen.
I couldn't even play it right there. Come on, Nick. Thank you, guys.
All
thank
right.
you. Amazing take six. Thank you for that performance. Here we're joined by our tenor player, Daniel Berkey, and our incredible legendary up. Vocalist, Mr. Mike Davis.
Right. Legendary.
Legendary. I want to ask you guys a quick question. I want to talk about background vocals. I wanted to talk about D'Angelo Voodoo record. What do you guys like? What are you guys' opinions on those type of background vocals, that type of approach?
Classic.
Killing, right?
Classic. Here's a story. I remember we were doing something in Nashville, and I think Mark had just got the CD, that CD you're talking about. And I was listening to it. I was like, dude, I got to drive to Huntsville. I will bring this back in 2 days, I promise. I mean, it was that impactful.
That kind of stuff is what feeds into us, and we get flavor from that.
Right.
And, you know, just know, you know, just about everything you listen to, and so that means be careful what you listen to. Because it's going in,
right.
It's going to come out.
Good word.
And D'Angelo, my goodness, he put some flavor on stuff that I will hold to my heart for the rest of my life.
Right.
It is so impactful, and emotional.
Right.
You know, it just, it comes out. So I'm grateful that he did what he did.
Mm-hmm. What are some of y'all's biggest influences like coming up?
Well, I mean, Earth, Wind, and Fire goes without saying.
Same.
That's a group-wide influence.
That's
right. Group-wide.
In the Stones.
Stevie.
Yep.
Marvin Winans.
Ooh, man.
Song stylist.
Man, Stevie. I want to.
So I got to say, though, you know, for us, you know, it was that early quartet stuff.
Right.
For the Jubilees and the Golden Gates and
Gene Perlin.
Yeah, man. The High Lows.
Yeah. And those, that.
I mean, even the Manhattan Transfer, you know? Yeah, groups like that. Absolutely.
And Andre Crouch as well.
Right.
Hawkins.
Yeah.
Come on, Hawkins.
Right. Yeah. So I wanted to ask you guys about Stevie because one of the biggest records for me, one of my favorite vocal performances of all time was O Thou That Tellest Good Tidings to Zion.
Oh, nice.
And a couple questions about that record. Like, so are there other records that you guys have done with like mostly diatonic kind of outro vamp like that? That people rip on? Is that kind of like one of the only ones?
I mean, that was a thing around that time period. You know, you sing the song, but you're really waiting to get to the vamp.
Right.
You know what I mean? And the vamp is really the hook
right.
that you're getting to. And so that vamp is very special. Funny thing about that song is that while it's a great song, it's hard for us to sing live, if that makes any sense.
Oh, yeah.
Because the range is so spread out. You know, that it goes extreme for Claude. I mean, it's way up there.
Yeah.
So, yes, and it's
my fault.
Well, we'd be singing it all the time.
That was one of the songs that I got a chance to what do they call it when you're comping the lead?
Yeah.
All of Stevie's takes. Every one of them were just, yeah. It was incredible. Brother, the stuff that we didn't use was like, oh, this is a crime. It should be somewhere. Oh, Stevie was just in a rare form, and it was just amazing.
What was funny is we were in the studio recording it, and he's like asking us to produce him.
Right.
And nobody wanted to step up to the
How do you tell Stevie, do it again?
can we get one more? Yeah, that was very difficult.
Sure. Wow.
Who actually stepped up? Was it Sid?
I think Sid, yes.
Yeah.
Let him use you. How many takes did he do?
We had three.
Three
and
takes.
All of them were amazing. Yo. All of them were amazing. And it was just, it was the most pleasant experience ever in comping a solo.
I mean, that's probably my favorite male vocal of all time. And well, really good choices on the comps.
Mm, with Aggie, brother.
Yeah.
So, but first of all, guys, it was amazing hearing you guys play live. It was really, an incredible experience for me. But you have such a sound. Like I could hear it without knowing it's take six, and mm-hmm. I could know it's take six.
Mm-hmm. We could have used you on a jury a few months back.
Oh yeah. Did you guys catch one of those lawsuits?
They didn't do it.
The Marvin Gaye estate. They couldn't have been.
Right.
Your Honor.
It's definitely take six. Okay. Wow. But how do you go about actually choosing a new song with six people in the group and everything? Is there Mark, are you kind of the master of that, or is it? How does it all work? Because I'm in a couple groups with a lot of people, and it's hard to get something that everyone's exactly on the same page.
That process.
He said it's because of me.
Yeah, it can be daunting, you know. And most of our albums, we bring songs to the table, whether or not we're writing them or finding them or whatever, and then we vote on them. New record we're working on right now was kind of the brainchild of our manager. Ed Keen. And so we're in the midst of doing a straight ahead jazz record.
Wow.
And it's a tough one. Yeah. You know, we're trying to figure out how to get our sound and our vocals,
maintain our identity.
Yeah, the integrity of the group in songs. And some of them aren't vocal songs. So we're trying to make that into our thing. And it's coming together.
Like some bebop stuff on there? Or
Absolutely.
Nice. Mm-hmm. I was listening to your guys' album, The Standard.
Mm-hmm.
That was really cool. Like the way you were handling a lot of that jazz stuff. So how are you approaching this one differently? Because there were some straight ahead songs on there. I guess more maybe traditional.
Well, I'll be honest with you. This was a tough one for me personally because I didn't grow up listening to jazz standards like that. So the song selections that our manager gave us, everything was foreign to me. Huh. And so he wanted a couple of different guys to arrange different songs. And I'm looking at this list and I'm like, I'm not feeling any of this, to be honest with you. I'm just not feeling. So you do get to that place. I think some people think that, you know, everything that artists record, everybody loves everything. That's not the truth. That's not how it really works.
Sure.
But the thing that got me involved or that sparked my fire was a conversation that we had. And Claude was actually like, yo, you be you. Do you on this song. Yes, this is what the standard sounds like. But if you can't relate to that, then do you on this song. Man, I ended up writing an intro to the song. And that was the key that made all of the colors come alive for me. And so you have to find a way to inspire yourself. If this is something that you have to do, then you figure out a way to make it yourself. You don't have to stay beholden to what it was before. That's the thing about take six. Whatever we do, we can do Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star, Mary Had a Little Lamb, whatever, but it's going to be take six.
Yeah.
So I had to come out of myself and be like, I had to get myself out of the box that I thought I was in. And
to say, be, you know, to become, you know, yourself.
To actually become who I was.
And be you. Wow. To be me.
Let me speak to some
in
of that
the nucleus.
Too. You know, whatever we do, they say, quote unquote, that it needs to come through me to become take six.
Facts.
It's not necessarily the case, but there is a sound that we are.
Yeah.
That that we have to make whatever is out there, the song that is chosen, and we want to make it something that we'll have fun singing,
absolutely,
we'll enjoy. And that's what the joy has to come through us, no matter whatever
facts
we do. So we're, you know, it might be a challenge, but that's our goal, to make that happen.
And the cool thing about what we're learning throughout this process is we won't stop. In other words, you don't just say, oh, this is what it is, let's just put it out. We continue arranging, rearranging, rearranging until we get to that place where we finally say, yes, we can appreciate this. This feels like us.
Don't miss what Mark just said, though, because the reality is we have to sing these songs.
Yeah.
We got to sing this. So I don't care if everybody in the world likes it. If we don't like it, it's not going in the show.
Okay.
You're not going to hear it if we don't enjoy singing it. So we have to be able to take whatever it is, make it enough us that we enjoy it. Because what the audience does not want, what you don't want, is to have us on stage singing something that we don't actually like. Right. So it's better for us to leave those things out of the show and do the ones that we feel passionate about. And that's what you're going to get from Take Six, because that's when you're going to get who we actually are in the nucleus.
That's what's up. I mean, we're running out of time over here. I wish we had all day. Mike, you want to say one more thing before we get out of here?
Yeah. Well, once again, it is a pleasure to hear you and see you guys. And thank God that you're all still here and still doing what you do, because you are a blessing to anybody that hears you. They cannot do anything else but be blessed by the message that you're giving out to the world.
Appreciate that.
The question I have is the, I guess, gospel music world for business, like the record companies, is it the same thing in secular as it is in gospel? Like the trappings and the things that you figure, because it's gospel music, that they're supposed to be holy.
Very much so.
Any business that makes money.
Is business that makes money.
That's right. Yeah,
very much so. And that's, we started going after that at the very beginning. If you have time, we could tell you all about it. And quickly found out that what we were going for, they didn't want us. We went a whole different direction.
Right.
Then they came around afterwards. But yeah, very much so. It could be a business. Ministries are businesses, right. So it's a lot of the same stuff. You just pray that the inspiration is coming from a different place.
Okay. The other question before y'all guys go, because I only got two. Favorite artists that you performed with that was like a fanned out moment for you?
Recorded or stage?
Either.
You can't say Nick.
For me, it might be different for every one of us.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
For you.
You said for me. For me, Marcus Miller. Marcus Miller was an experience, both in recording and with live performance. Okay. He is just a
great
good
friend,
guy.
Great mentor. I mean, he's experienced so much.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I like that.
Man. For me, we did that song, "Oh Thou That Tellest Good Tidings to Zion." We did it with Fred Hammond and Marvin Sapp.
Wow.
The both of them. The moment we walked out on stage.
No. The rehearsal, bro.
The rehearsal was
legendary.
It was insane. It actually went viral.
Wow. Yeah. It was more fun than the actual performance. Wow.
Crazy.
Yeah, for sure. Obviously, Stevie, because, way back in the day, we would be out on stage with him. And there are historic moments that happen that I'm not going to get into right now. But obviously, that's one of them.
Some of the newer artists, Jacob Collier.
Oh, man. Yeah, right.
That's a whole Absolutely. Experience unto itself.
That's right.
But we did a recording session or a couple of days with Dr. Dre.
Yo.
And that was crazy cool.
You'll never hear the music, but it's amazing.
One of these days.
All right, guys. Well, Take Six, it was an honor to have you here today.
Thank you guys so much.
I think we're going to end with a quick song. And here we go. Let's get into it.
Let's get in it.
Your You are, you are.